Aaron, welcome back.
Hello, Sophie. Great to be back for our third and final Coronation Club.
In this episode, we'll look at how a monarch travels, open an ancient book, find out about Holy Communion, hear the tale of a coronation catastrophe, sing the national anthem, take part in our final Queen's quiz, and make a special coronation viewer.
So, from previous videos, we know what a coronation is and lots of the objects used in a coronation. Now we're asking, how does a coronation happen?
Well, we know a crown or two go on someone's head, but remember, it's more than just a crown. In fact, some past coronations lasted up to 5 hours, so there must be loads more involved. What else happens?
And where does the crowning fit into the whole thing?
Well, Sophie, I know one thing. Coronations happen here at Westminster Abbey, so an important stage must be getting the monarch here.
Good point.
Some, like Elizabeth I, actually walked here, but today there must be slightly fancier modes of transport available.
And where do they start their journey?
Well, our roving reporter has been out and about and can tell us a bit more.
Welcome to Buckingham Palace, the official London residence of the monarch. Sadly, there's no time for me to pop in and have a cup of tea today because I'm here to find out how, in the past, monarchs travelled to Westminster Abbey on Coronation Day. Well, to find out more, come with me. We're going to pop behind the palace and visit the Royal Mews. Wow, look at all these coaches. Which one do you like best? I think this one's my favourite. It looks like something out of a fairy tale, doesn't it? Like Cinderella's coach. It's called the Gold State Coach, and it looks like it weighs a ton. In fact, it weighs 4 tons. It's so heavy. 8 horses are needed to pull it. It can only move at walking pace, but that's okay because people lining the streets can see the face of the monarch as it passes by. There is so much decoration here. These are funny creatures, aren't they? They look like men, but they've got fish's tails. They're called tritons, and they're announcing the new monarch using those shells. I know you must be wondering whether this is made from solid gold, but it's actually made from wood and it's got a thin layer of gold leaf painted on it. It certainly looks like a wonderful way to ride around London, but my sources have told me that it's not very comfortable to sit in. Queen Victoria actually refused to ride in it. And Queen Elizabeth II had to have a hot water bottle under her seat on her coronation day to help her keep warm. So traditionally, the soon-to-be-crowned monarch would be picked up at Buckingham Palace and travel by coach to Westminster Abbey. As for me, I'm going to go and catch a bus.
Well, that's an incredible coach. If you were going somewhere special, how would you like to travel? So now the monarch has arrived. We can begin looking at all the stages of the coronation.
Last time we found out about the anointing, where the monarch is anointed with holy oil to show that they've been set apart by God, the most sacred part of the ceremony.
And the investiture, where the monarch receives all of the coronation regalia, like the sceptres and the orb. Who could forget all that bling? Coronations are complicated, so actually you get a big book, The Order of Service, to help everyone follow along and know what's happening.
Speaking of books, there's a very important book here at the Abbey that I think Gemma and Ewan have found on their treasure hunt, and it can tell us a little bit more about coronations.
This is the Liber Regalis, or Royal Book. It was made over 600 years ago.
And it may have been designed to help people organise and run coronations, like a really old order of service. Details of coronations have changed through the years, but the basic running order remains the same.
The illustrations, or illuminations, are a step-by-step guide on the crowning of a king alone, a queen alone, and a king and queen together.
It also contains the words that the monarch must say and music that should be included. So the Liber Regalis is really a ceremonial instruction book and a really old Christian order of service that has been used for many hundreds of years.
Fantastic! Who knew the Abbey has a medieval manuscript explaining how coronations are staged? How useful!
And we've collected a couple more stages of the coronation service too. The crowning, where the monarch is crowned. And if Sophie was getting crowned, we'd all shout, God save the Queen!
And if Aaron was getting crowned, we'd all shout,
God save the King! God save the King! God save the King.
Because it's shouted three times. I know you want to practice that. So pause the video and we'll cover our ears while you do.
And that's the crowning. Aaron?
Oh, pardon?
We also just heard the Liber Regalis tells us the words that must be spoken by the monarch. During the recognition and oath, the monarch is presented to the people and must swear an oath to uphold the law and the church. What kind of promises would you want a monarch to make? The next stage is for something called the enthronement and homage, part of which includes the monarch receiving Holy Communion or the Eucharist. Luckily, we have someone on hand to tell us a bit more about that.
Holy Communion, also known as the Eucharist, is of central importance to Christians, and the monarch is the head of the Church of England. It is fitting, then, that as part of the coronation, the monarch would traditionally share in Holy Communion by receiving bread and wine which have been blessed. This receiving of sacred bread and wine goes back to a particular meal, often called the Last Supper. This was a meal that Jesus shared with his friends and followers, his disciples, just before he was arrested and put to death. At that meal, Jesus took bread, and as he broke it, he gave it to them. He told his friends that his body would be broken, and that he would be poured out just like the wine, and that he would be offering himself for them and for the whole world. Jesus asked them to remember him every time from then on that they ate and drank bread and wine together. When in a coronation, a new monarch receives a small piece of bread and a sip of wine in Holy Communion, they are stepping into the invitation to draw close to Jesus, to receive from him, and to be given food and strength for all that lies ahead. They are also reminded that they too are to give themselves for others, just as Jesus did.
So, for the enthronement and
homage,
for that, the monarch moves from the coronation chair and sits on the throne. Some of those in the abbey kneel and promise to serve them. And we just heard that they receive Holy Communion or the Eucharist.
Now, there's one last part, the closing procession, when the monarch processes out of the abbey wearing the imperial state crown and carrying the orb and sovereign scepter with cross. The national anthem is sung as they leave. This is either God Save the King or Queen, depending on the monarch. Now we've collected all the stages of the coronation ceremony. Should we play a game to see which order we think that they might go in?
Let's do it.
Brilliant. I call it out of order. On the screen we can see six stages of a coronation. Remember, they're in the wrong order. Your challenge is to try and work out when in the ceremony you think each stage might happen and why. Pause the video while you talk to each other.
Okay, all done.
Great. Shall we see which order they go in?
First out the gate is the recognition and oath. After that, we have the anointing, just before the investiture. And now the moment you've been waiting for, the crowning, followed by enthronement and homage. And last but not least, the procession.
How did you do? As we said before, there can be so many parts to a coronation. Do you think it always runs smoothly?
Well, now you mention it, I do wonder what happens when things go wrong. I wonder if Will might be able to tell us a little bit more.
Can you imagine? It's your coronation, your big day. Nothing could possibly go wrong, right? After all, the Abbey even has its own coronation instruction manual, the Liber Regalis, detailing everything you might need to say or do. But things do go wrong. A few kings and queens have had coronation catastrophes. Richard II, only 10 years old at the time of his coronation in 1377, fell asleep midway through and had to be carried out of the abbey. I bet he woke up for the party afterwards. You'd think you'd scrub up for such a big event, particularly when it's all about you. But not Henry IV. When the Archbishop of Canterbury lowered the crown upon the new king's head, he was shocked to notice it was teeming with lice. Yeah, But one monarch had so much more to deal with at her coronation. Queen Victoria, crowned in 1838 and only 19 at the time. Imagine her excitement and hope that above all else, her coronation would go without any mishaps. How wrong she was. The coronation ring was way too big for her tiny finger, so a smaller copy was made. But the Archbishop, who obviously hadn't read the Liber Regalis, tried to put the ring on the wrong finger, pushing and straining until, pop, it was on. Ouch. It was only later, when the Queen was able to soak her hand in icy water, that at long last, she was able to take the wretched thing off. If that wasn't bad enough, one of the bishops told her the service was done and dusted, but before she could leave the abbey, they realised he'd accidentally turned over two pages of the service book. Victoria was called back so they could finish the coronation properly. But the new queen took all these disasters in her stride and, at the end of the day, commented how her coronation day was the proudest of my life.
That is a good reminder that practice makes perfect. My dad always says that prior preparation and planning prevents a pretty poor performance.
Top advice.
In the spirit of practicing, if you want to, why not have a go of singing the national anthem? Follow the words on the screen.
Seems like a good time to face our final Queen's Quiz. So maybe we should say instead,
God save the Queen!
Well, I do like to hear God save the Queen echoing across the Abbey. Welcome back to this final edition of the Queen's Quiz. Let's see how you get on with all things how of a coronation. Question one. In which book can this beautiful illumination of a coronation be found? Is it A, the Order of Service, B, the Liber Regalis, or C, the Bible? Yes, it's B, the Liber Regalis, or Royal Book, which helps with the running and organising of all coronations. And now for question two. Which Queen's coronation could have used a bit more preparation after quite a few things went wrong? Well done if you said Queen Victoria, you're quite correct. And finally, question three. Why does the monarch take Eucharist? Is it A, because it allows the monarch to remember Jesus? B, because it's a long service and they might get peckish? Or C, because they want everyone to remember that they're the monarch? The answer's A, to remember Jesus. Well, how did you do? Top marks or top of the flops? If you enjoyed my quiz, maybe you could create one for yourself and become your own real quiz master. I grant you permission. Now, be gone.
Well done, everyone.
I'm wondering, because nowadays people could watch a coronation on the TV or on the internet, but in the past, how did people get a sense of what a coronation was like?
Good question. So one answer is this amazing peep show which commemorates Queen Victoria's eventful coronation. It unfolds to create a 3D image, a bit like a theatre set, to show the coronation service.
I don't know about you, Sophie, but I'm excited to make my own viewfinder based on this one. It's going to show some of the different stages of the coronation. To join in, here's what you'll need. Templates, which are available to download on our website, or you can draw your own on paper or card. Some scissors, some colouring pencils, or you can use pens, and sellotape. So my design has six pieces. The front piece shows the west front of the abbey to represent the monarch's arrival. Then, on the next piece, I've got an empty book to represent the recognition and oath, and I'm going to write my own promise in there. Then, that's followed by the ampulla and the spoon to represent the anointing. And for the investiture, I've chosen the orb and the sceptre. Then the next piece is the coronation chair and a crown to represent the crowning. And then the back piece is the Abbey's west window. And I'm going to make that really nice and colourful. First of all, cut out each strip. And then you'll have six individual pieces that you're going to colour in. When you finish colouring in, the next step is to cut out five windows so you can see all the way through. Almost fold the piece in half and then snip into it. Then you want to cut all the way around. You might want to get help from a grown-up with this bit. And then you should be able to see right through. And then you need to fold all of the tabs. For the first scene, you fold it backwards, the top and the bottom, to create a box. All the other windows, we're going to fold the tab forward. I'm then going to stick the front and the second tab together to create a nice big gap between them. And now I'm just going to build each one onto the start. And with the last piece on, my coronation viewer is complete and I can have a look at my own view.
Those viewers are a lovely reminder of what we've explored. Remember to share your makes with us using hashtag Coronation Club. Well, I've really enjoyed exploring coronations with you, Aaron, and with all of our friends.
And with all of you watching. Hopefully you've enjoyed it, learnt something new, asked lots of questions, and made some fantastic crafts. If you want, you could bring everything together to reenact your own coronation, wherever you are.
Thanks so much for joining us as we close up the final
Coronation Club.